We're going to get started now. Next up, we have David Molnar, who's going to talk about Wasabi Wallet. Thank you, David, for joining us.
Thank you. So Wasabi Wallet is an open source, non-custodial, privacy-oriented wallet, which implements a trustless coin join, coin shuffle, with a mathematically provable anonymity, Xiaomian coin join, and it's first of its kind. But before we go into the details, to wake you and me up, let's go get a coffee. Yes. So here we are in the coffee shop, and we are buying that coffee with Bitcoin. Meanwhile, we are drinking that hot and tasty coffee. Let's have a conversation about what happened in the privacy and security point of view. Well, what's pretty obvious that you have exposed your identity to the cashier. In an online environment, it's pretty the same because of the Know Your Customer policy, as known as KYC policy. You also have to identify yourself. So the transaction is connected to your personal identity. Imagine the following situation. Every time you go into a grocery shop and buy something, your total balance is displayed to the cashier. Well, that's not only an uncomfortable feeling, but it's also dangerous. From the input of the transaction, she can trace your past transaction. From the change output of the transaction, she might trace down your future transactions. So if you are using your Bitcoin in the same way you are using your credit card, this might can happen. To create that transaction, you need a wallet. Light wallets and hot wallets are directly tied, many of them directly tied to a third-party server. So every action you take are forwarded to them. If they decide, they can easily spying on you. Also, many of these wallets behold the keys. So, I mean the private keys, so you don't have it. But with Wasabi, because it's a non-custodial wallet, your private keys is stored in a wallet file on your computer in an encrypted format. Last time, and that was the last time when I used my Coinbase wallet, I was required to upload a photo of my passport. Until that, I was logged out from my wallet. So that's why it's important. If you have the keys, it's your Bitcoin. If you don't have the keys, it's not your Bitcoin. They can easily lock you out in any time. The next feature of Wasabi Wallet is coin control. Many wallets are only displaying your total UTXO, but in reality, it is fragmented into coins. With the coin control feature, you can see these coins and select which coin will take part in a particular transaction. So for example, in this way, you can avoid to pay with your salary for that cafe. In Wasabi, there is also an advanced labeling system. With every transaction you make, you can add a small label. So at the end, every coin will have a history of their path. To propagate the transaction, this wallet needs to be connected to the network. Network is a dangerous place. There is no light wallet which would not fail in the privacy point of view against network analysis. So every light wallet is vulnerable against network analysis. Many of these wallets are just querying web API. So for example, to establish your full UTXO, your address is queried from the same source in the same time and just connected together. There are supernodes in the network which are collecting metadata about the source of any traffic. So for example, your IP address is stored or logged. Okay, how can we solve this? Well, one option is to run a full node, which is my recommendation, but it's not possible because it's not possible in most of the cases because it's very resource intense. Another solution is a new proposal, BIP-158, which is currently in the progress of finalization, apparently in discussion, where instead of querying addresses, you are querying blocks. From the blocks, it is very hard to determine which transaction are you interested in. That sounds good, but how do we know on client side which block is required to know that transaction? Well, the solution is that you have a constant filters. You have a constant set of filters on client side. From that, you can determine which block is required to you. Because this feature is not yet implemented in Bitcoin Core, we have to implement it our own backend. So that's how Wasabi gets its filters from our own backend. Bitcoin often described as an anonymous cryptocurrency, but that's not true. Bitcoin is pseudonymous. The distinction is crucial. Under a cryptographic pseudonym, your behavior can still be tracked. We covered many topics here, many issues, but one more, maybe the most trivial, is remained, that the transaction chain is still there, it's visible, and it's traceable. So what can we do about it? Let's try mixing, for example. The trivial solution is when you try to generate, let's say, thousands of transactions on your own with varying inputs and outputs. But to be honest, it's not really good because it's not so private. For example, if coins from the same wallet, if you generate this lot of transactions from the same wallet, the begin and the end transaction could be determined by running a breadth first search on the transaction graph. And that's it. Also, it can be very expensive to generate a lot of transactions. So you have to have more users to guarantee the privacy. In the past, centralized mixers provide a way to obfuscate the ledger. You send them the coin, they will send back the mix coin for you, if they will. For example, Bitcoin Fog worked for years without any issue, had a good feedback, but after a while it became a selective scam. If you send them the money, it mixes. If you send a larger amount, it will take it. So there is two problems with this. First, they can store your money. The second, if they are using some logging, they can easily de-anonymize you later. One solution for this is to generate a coin join transaction. The point is that from the outputs, it is very hard to decide which input belongs to. So for the first look, it's hard. But if we look at closer, we can make some assumptions. Because of the input sum is equal with the output sum, we can make some amount analysis and start the game, if you know, Sudoku. Start the coin join Sudoku. So imagine that this transaction is written in a format of a Sudoku. The inputs are the rows, the outputs are the columns. And you have to solve this Sudoku. So for example, Alice's output must be that output because she have only one BTC. She cannot have more at the end of the transaction. So that's Alice's. With the same logic, we can continue de-anonymizing the user. At the end, we manage to de-anonymize all of the users. So It's also called amount analysis or subset sum analysis. So this, how to make a mathematically provable anonymity? Well, the solution is to use equal outputs regarding the amount, like this. So we set up a fixed denomination, for example, 1 BTC, and we generate 4 equal outputs. In that way, amount analysis won't work. So from that 4 equal outputs, you cannot say which input belongs to. You have a quarter probability to tell that. So that's we are saying the anonymity set is 4 for that coins. Of course, in reality, not every user will come with the exact amount of denomination, so there will be some change at the end. Sorry, there. But its anonymity set is 1, so it's not private coins, but the user can decide to continue coin join their coins until the whole amount is mixed. Of course, they can remix the one with anonymity set 4 to increase that. Okay, so we got a good coin join transaction which is private, but how can we construct this transaction? Wasabi has the following solution. We have a backend, we are running a software, backend software there, let's say coordinator, and instead of taking the coins from the user, we are just collecting some information to construct that final coin join transaction which you saw before. And at the end, the user, I mean the Wasabi wallet, so the users can verify that transaction, and if it is constructed good, they can sign it. So there is no way somebody can steal your money, even the coordinator cannot do neither. So the first step is to collect enough user to do this. For example, here is Alice. She selects one of her coins, which she would like to mix. With the coin control feature, this can be done easily. She also generates 2 outputs. 1 output for the fixed denomination, for the mixed coin, and 1 output for the change address. Yes, for the change. Okay, that's good, but now if Alice sends this information to the coordinator, then it can easily de-anonymize her later, because input and the mixed output send with the same package. So to solve this, we are using Snore signatures. We heard a lot about that before. So in that way, we blind the output address. It's good because in that way, the coordinator can sign this output without knowing it, without knowing the address. So the coordinator signed this blinded output and sends back the signature for us, for Alice, and on client side, it is unblinded. So as a result, we will have a signature for Shi's output, but the coordinator don't know the output address. So it's impossible to de-anonymize the user, even for us, even for Wasabi. It's impossible to do because the output was sent blinded. Okay, on the right side, you can see the construction of the coin join transaction. We have the inputs, we have the change outputs. So we continue, we have to wait enough users. Currently, Wasabi is working with anonymity set about 50. So we have to wait for 50 users to register. After we got enough users, we move to the next phase. This input registration can take time, 2 minutes to hours, from minutes to hours. So It depends on user activity, of course. After this, we confirm if the users are still there. And if we got enough users, we move to the next phase, output registration. So we need the equal outputs there, which is missing currently, to construct the coin join transaction. Okay, the client sends the output, but before moving forward, we have to stop for a while here. Wasabi is using the internet to connect to the coordinator. Internet is also a dangerous place. As I mentioned before, Wasabi using Tor anonymity network. Well, basically Tor doing two things. The first is to hide the source of the traffic. The second is to encrypt, to give end-to-end encryption to the data. So in this way, we are protected against the internet. I mean against, for example, a man-in-the-middle attack or using a public Wi-Fi or so on. So we are protected against these kind of dangers. But there is another, we are not protected against our coordinator. So remember, we sent our input at the input registration. So now if we are sending our unblinded output address here on the same channel, the coordinator would know which input corresponds to which mixed output, and that way we could de-anonymize you. That's not good. So to solve this, we are using another Tor identity, another Tor channel to send the unblinded output. And to verify that we are not just a random guy who are trying to send fake outputs to the coordinator, we also add the output signature there. So that way the coordinator can verify if the output is valid, so it was registered in the input registration. Well, the next phase is to wait enough outputs. So if you look on the right, we are almost done. What is missing? The input signatures. So the next part is to deliver this unsigned transaction to every client. So on client side, it verifies the transaction if it is good. For example, my input is there. My output is there and the amounts are okay. My change output is there and the amounts are okay. If it is good, then the client sends back their input signature. Here it is. So we have everything and everything to broadcast the transaction. So the coordinator broadcasts it to the nodes. What happens if something is smelly? So the transaction is not good. Maybe my output is missing, or the coordinator would like to do something to store someone's money. Well, in that case, the client could decide, I'm not signing this transaction. So what happens is not that she is losing her money, but only to disrupt one coin join round and to go on and start again. So there is a lot of coin join rounds, and these four phases go through. If something happening, then it restarts. Of course, in the reality, this procedure is more complex. We have to add a lot of DOS protection and hashes during, but basically that's the idea. So Wasabi is not only protecting your privacy against others, but protecting it against us, against the Wasabi team. So the only one you have to trust in is yourself. So that's how it is trustless. That's it. Thank you.
We have time for one question. If anyone has a question, please come in the front. There's a mic here.
Hi, thank you for the great presentation. I was wondering, with Wasabi Wallet, would you say that since it's so focused on privacy,
yes,
is there any need for other privacy-focused coins for transactions like Monero?
Wasabi Wallet is a Bitcoin wallet, so you can use only Bitcoin in it. I don't know if this was the question.
I'm sorry, what I meant to say was, are there any benefits to only using like Wasabi Wallet for Bitcoin transactions, or would you, if you wanted to have a private transaction, would you also use a different coin that's focused on privacy in the coin itself?
Mm-hmm. Okay, we have chosen Bitcoin because it's the most common way to pay with a cryptocurrency, and there were no really private solutions to do this. Even you saw, even a balance request can be dangerous with light wallets. So that was the goal, to provide something very private wallet in the world of Bitcoin. Yes.
Cool. Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you, David. Thank you so much. That was great.
Thank you.